My name is Minnie White Watson, and this is the Mega Evers Historic House that right now is owned and operated by Tougaloo College. After Mega was assassinated, Mrs. Evers lived here roughly a year and a half or so, raising monies to get out of here. She wanted to leave Mississippi. So she took her family and she moved to Claremont, California. She said she had some friends there and they encouraged her to come there. So she sold Mega's car and quite a bit of her furnishings, and then the National NAACP helped her support her move to California, and that's where she still is, in Claremont. Mega came into this community after he became the first field secretary for the Mississippi NAACP. And when you would hear Mega talk, he always would talk about his growing up. He said, I grew up when it was in a time when it was in my face segregation, and he didn't understand that. He didn't like it, didn't know why it had to be that way. He had very strong parents. And he said, I would talk to my parents about it, especially my dad, and my dad would tell me, Mega, that's how things are. But it does not make you less of a person because of how people treat you, because you're supposed to know who you are. But there are some things you're gonna have to do to survive in this kind of environment. But Mega talked about, by the time I was 12 years old, I had witnessed two lynchings. He said one was a friend of my dad's. He said my dad and I were in the woods one morning and we came up on these men lynching one of my father's friends. He said, I thought it was so cruel. He said, I asked my dad, why would they do that? He said, that's what they do, but what you must do in order for it not to happen to you. And then he said, after they lynched him, they cut him down and they drug him downtown to show him off. Mega said, it was working with me. In other words, it was working on my mind. And then he talked about a 10-year-old kid going to the Mississippi White Fair, the state fair. The fair would come into your area at various times and it would operate so many days as whites only. Then they'd close it down and take away some of, we would say, the goodies, and they'd open it back up and it would become the colored fair. In fact, it would have less of the goods, I would say, the good food, some of the rides and other activities. In fact, I met a man, it's been about two or three months ago, and he said he's from Alabama. He said the fair would come in for the colors and it would operate just one day. At least we had more than one day. But anyway, Mega talked about that kid. It's a black kid that went to the white fair. He said they lynched that kid, put him on a fence, and they left him there until his body began to deteriorate, took him down and buried him, but they left his clothes there. And Mega saw that as a warning to both races. This is what can happen to you when you step out of line, because he talked about that kid's bodies hanging on that fence for a while and no one talked about it, neither white or black, and they were passing that kid. So, you know, he's had enough of this. So at the age of 16, quits high school, goes into World War II. And he talked about traveling, defending America. He said it didn't seem to matter too much about the color of my skin as long as I'm fighting. He said, then I get out of home, get out of service, comes home, and that stuff starts all over again. He talked about trying to register to vote on his 21st birthday, because back then you had to be 21 to vote. He said, these group of white men ran us off with shotguns. He said, we went home and got ours. And when we came back, he said, that number had tripled. He said, and an old white lady was sitting in a truck off to the side. She steps out of her truck, walks over to us and says, son, don't lose your life over this. One day you'll be able to vote. So Mega gets serious. He said, let me get busy. So he gets into Alcorn College. At that time, Alcorn had the high school and then the college. He finishes his 2 years of high school and enters college, majoring in business administration. He does a lot of stuff while he's down there. He starts some business ventures. He's taking people. He has a car. He's a little older than the average student. So he has a car. He takes people clothing to the cleaners, take them to town to shop, that kind of thing. But one of the most important things he did, he organized the first debate team. And he was the first black to debate at Millsaps College, then an all-white college here in Jackson. Millsaps students got involved as well. And Millsaps, they would come to Tougaloo College, and Tougaloo College would intermingle with them. Once Mega finished college, of course, he met Merle. She was a freshman. They got married. And when he finished college, they moved to a little all-black town up in the Mississippi Delta, Mound Bayou, Mississippi. In Mound Bayou, they had this hospital there. And a young black doctor, Dr. T.R.M. Howard, who had an insurance company, he was running that hospital. And he invited Megan. He said, Megan, you need a job. Why don't you come up here and sell insurance for me? And Megan said, that's what I went up there to do, to sell insurance. He said, T.R., pull me under his wings, if you will, and began teaching me about organizing. He talked about he started selling insurance in the little town of Clarksdale, and he saw how colored people were living, because that's how they referred to us then, how colored people were living. He said, I started talking to them about voting and education. Right away, they let me know, Mr. Evers, they don't let us vote. And then he said, I just continued talking to them. He said, I did get some to join the NAACP, and they did have some schools around. He said, then I left that town, and I went out there on those big farms, those things you all call plantations. And this is when I really saw how people were living. He said, I'm talking about some poor whites as well as the colors. He said, some of those folks didn't have wooden floors, not windows in their homes. I felt bad. He said, I started talking to them about the same thing, voting and education. Got the same thing. Mr. Evers, they don't let us vote. It ain't no schools. If so, we go to school so long, so many weeks, and we right back out here on these farms. He said, I just continued talking to them. Until one day I made a big mistake. I give a young black man a voter registration application. He couldn't read nor write. He thought it was for insurance. He takes it to his boss to help him complete the app because he wants insurance. When the man sees what it is, he gets together with the rest of the plantation owners, and they will not allow Mega back onto their properties. He said, that's okay. We can still change some minds. Let's do some boycotts. He said, he asked me, what's that? And I told him, well, you know, they let us buy the gas, won't let us use their bathrooms. We go into their stores, they raise the prices when we walk in. And sometimes they make us stand in line till all the white folks are served. We're gonna get people who got cars to come in here and take you outside the area. He said, we began doing this. And they began, those attitudes changed. And then he talked about in 1954, when the first Educational Act was passed, you can go to school wherever. Megan said, I always wanted to be a lawyer. Only school in the state of Mississippi that offered a law degree, University of Mississippi, now Ole Miss. Unbeknownst to many, a black man, if you want to call him that, had attended Ole Miss before Megan tried. His mama was white and his daddy was black, so he passed and got in, and you'll read, he went one semester and left. And so when Mega tried, they wouldn't let him in. And that's when the National NAACP said, Mr. Evers, how about becoming field secretary for the Mississippi NAACP? Had never had one before. That means Mega has to come into Jackson. And he's coming in here, he's dealing with 82 counties in the state of Mississippi. He's trying to get people registered to vote. He becomes an investigator of beatings and murders and that kind of thing. And so he comes into this little neighborhood on this little, we said this little simple street, because there were two young black World War II veterans had owned this property, this one street, for a long time. They wanted to do houses for what they call middle class professional blacks, lawyers, doctors, teachers, whatever, considered professional. And these were your first houses in the area that had the hardwood floors, the faux brick fronts, that kind of thing. But they would not allow these two young men to build the houses because this one street is sandwiched between two white streets. Whites are moving in back here, and whites are already on Missouri Street up here. Except when Mega came in here, the first four houses were not on that end yet. They started moving in on the lower end. And so these two guys finally got permission, go ahead and build your houses. We'll see how long they last. Mega said, I came in here, not that I considered myself a professional. He said, but I had a connection. They're veterans and so am I. And then I can get me a home, a house on the GI Bill. So he came in and he selected this lot. There was a house standing on the left and one was on the right. He said, I did that to nestle my house between the two because I'm bringing a wife and two kids in here. And he came in here, and as they began to work on his house, he asked them, he said, do two things for me. I have a wife and two kids. He said, at this time, all bedrooms are on the east wall. Raise those windows a little bit higher, and then don't give me a front door. So you drive around, you won't find another house in the area without a front door. He said, because I'm going to teach my kids especially if it's night, whoever brings them home, they got to pull under the carport and let them out. And they are to get out of the car on the passenger side, using the wall and the car as a means of protection. Come down that wall and right into this house. And he said, that's how we began to live. And then Mrs. Evers talks about, she said, the very first time, year we were here, she said, someone shot through this window. And this is when she said, we placed the piano on one corner. Her piano was a little smaller than this one. We placed it on one corner. On the other corner, Megan said, stand the couch on end. That's just so people can't walk up and look right in. Drop the kids' beds on the floor. Put the mattresses on the floor. She said, that's what we did. The second and third time it was shot into was through their bedroom window. She said, we all got on the floor then. But now when you go back there, there's a bed up back there. That's because after Megan was assassinated, they lived here a little bit better than a year. Mrs. Evers raising monies and stuff to get out of here. She said she was hurt, she was angry, and people were still messing with she and her family. So she got out of here, and Castle Rock Entertainment, after she left, she rented her house twice. And then for a long period, no one was in it. Tougaloo College asked for it, let us have it because of her connection. She had become a trustee member and Megan's connection with Tougaloo. She thought about it. She finally let us have it. And once we got it and came in and did some major work, Castle Rock Entertainment, Rob Reiner, executive producer, director, came in and wanted to use the house for some of the scenes, the movie, The Ghost of Mississippi. And that's how they came in and furnished it. But then she also talked about, she said, Megan traveled so much. She said, we were home alone a lot. She said, one night someone tried to come in on us through the back door. We simply pushed the refrigerator across the back door and left it that way. Then she and the neighbors, because they're still here, some of them, began to talk about the night of the assassination, June 12, 1963. Coming up to Freedom Summer. And you know, Freedom Summer is when all of them, when, as they say, it broke loose. A lot of people came in here, but people were already in Mississippi doing things. But a lot of people came in here from the various states. Some went up in the Mississippi Delta doing things, soliciting clothing, books, setting up schools. Some were right around in here trying to get people registered to vote, and they became investigators, really. And so they were going to march the next day. But John Kennedy was our president, and John Kennedy went on television that night and delivered what especially black people called his first civil rights speech, talking about things that was happening, but also he was working on legislations, that kind of stuff. And to kind of, in so many words, as they put it then, cool it, you know, give him some time. But they held, there was a mass meeting held down at New Jerusalem Baptist Church that night. And Megan watched Kennedy's speech. He left his office over by Jackson State in the Masonic Temple building. He left there, went downtown to New Jerusalem Baptist Church. And a lot of people said Beckwith and two of his friends were sitting on a back pew. And nobody paid them any attention, which you would not have done necessarily because you got so many whites involved. And then Megan left there and went, picked up T-shirts that had on the front, Jim Crow must go. The marchers were going to wear those shirts the next day. He came home, pulled in his driveway behind Mrs. Evers. He gets out of his car and went in his trunk and got the T-shirts. And when he straightens up and turns to come under the carport, Beckwith is waiting for him. When you go out, you'll see a beige house with blue shutters. It wasn't there. That's where he was. He stood and fired with a 30-yard 6-inch rifle. And the bullet catches Meg in his back under his right shoulder, goes through him, through the last pane of the window, through the wall, on into the kitchen, hitting her refrigerator dead center because she got it pulled across the back door. Ricocheted from there over to the countertop. Underneath the radio, there's a little nick where it hit. Came back down on the countertop, resting underneath this large watermelon she had. She said the kids and I were in the back watching TV, watching a rerun of John Kennedy's speech. Kids always sat on the floor. She said, we heard Mega drive up. He didn't come right in, so we just continued to watch TV. She said, then we hear this loud shot. She said, we hit the floor, began crawling across the hallway to the bathroom. Because the kids had told Megan, should something happen, the safest place in the house is the bathtub. She said, that's where they were headed, and I was crawling right behind them. And then I hear this loud thump, sound like something hit the house. She said, I don't know what it is, but I'd jump up and I'd run through, open the door, and when I did, Megan is staggering, coming around my car, trying to get to this door. She said, then I heard two more shots. I thought they were still shooting at us. I slammed that door and ran back in. The other two shots came from the man next door, Mr. Wells. His kids were in bed, and the first window you see was Paulette's bedroom. Paulette was 12 years old. Paulette said, we had bunk beds. I had the top bunk. I saw Mr. Evers drive up, get out of his car, went in his trunk, and he came up out of there with an armful of white stuff that I learned later was T-shirts. She said, then I heard that loud shot. She said, Mr. Evers was falling and struggling, hanging on to the poles in the cars, getting up. I was scared. I was just jumping up and down in my bed screaming, she said. And my daddy came running in there and looked out the window, saw Mr. Evers, got his pistol and walked out on his porch and fired two shots in the air. Mr. Wells said, I didn't see anybody. He said, I was just hoping to run whoever it was away. I simply fired in the air. Mrs. Evers said, we did not go back out until we heard talking. A man named Mr. Quinn lived on the end. He said, when he heard the shots, he just started running into the neighborhood. He said, and when I made it this far, Mr. Wells was under the carport struggling with Megan. He said, I stopped. We picked him up and brought him in here and placed him right here on the floor. Mrs. Evers said, we waited on an ambulance that never came for him. She said, after a bit, Mr. Wells asked for a mattress. So the first room was the daughter's room. They took took a mattress off of Rena's bed, put Megan on it, and put him in Mr. Wells' station wagon. And Mrs. Evers said, Mr. Wells said to her, I'm going to the closest hospital and the best. He was considering it the best because at that time, it was basically all white. The basement was reserved for colors, but no colors worked there except one lady, a nurse. But Mr. Wells said when he made it there, a couple of people came out, looked in his car and saw Meg and began apologizing. They were apologizing really because you brought him to the wrong place, not a colored hospital, on and on. Only one colored person worked there. That was one nurse, Miss Emma Matthews. But eventually, Mr. Wells said a man came up and said, if they allow you to bring him in, I'll work on him. And he said they took Megan in. The people in the hospital took Megan in. And of course, they really worked on him. Dr. Britton, Megan's doctor, Dr. Britton been dead now about what, 2.5 years, I say. But Dr. Britton said, I went there. Just in case they had said there is no doctor, I would have said I'm one. He said, but at that time, I didn't have permission to work there. He said, I could admit my patients, but I could not work there. And so he said, but they didn't know who Megan was until I made it there. And I asked the question, do you know who this is? And when they told me no, and I said, this is Megan Evers. He said, one of the doctors said, oh my God, we have Megan Evers in here. But Dr. Britton said they really worked on Megan. He said, but what we were so amazed that Megan was alert, talking and making good sense at first. He began to lose it after about 30, 35 minutes. He said, because we were so amazed because half of Megan's chest was missing. It was no longer there. We know Megan didn't make it. He's buried in Arlington National Cemetery. We know that the man that assassinated him, Byron Dealer Beckwith, it took them about 31 years, 31 plus years to find him guilty. And they sentenced him to life in prison. Spent a lot of time right downtown in the jail. From there, they took him to Rankin County Penal Farm. That's where he spent the rest of his life. And they talk about he wouldn't eat any dark foods, wouldn't drink a dark pop. And eventually, he died. And he died in the same hospital Megan died in, just bigger and better. It's now the University Medical Center. And I did learn he's buried up in the mountains up in Tennessee, because that's where he had fled when that second, when they brought him back for that third and final trial. Mrs. Evers and her kids are in California, well, that's where she went to California, Claremont. She is still there. The oldest son, Daryl was 9 when this happened. Daryl changed a lot. Mrs. Evers said he didn't talk for quite a while. And then she said a coach got him and began working with him with sports and kind of brought him back. Daryl died in 2001. Rena, the daughter who was 8, Rena lives right here in Jackson. She and her mom founded the Megan Merle Evers Institute, and Rena runs it here in Jackson. The baby boy, James Van Dyke, he was only 3. He is still in California, Claremont. He and his family is still in Claremont, California. And Van would tell you, I don't remember my dad. He said, I remember what my mom taught me about my, and others taught me about my dad. The we talk about the driveway being made historic at first, because when you walk out, this is Medgar's blood in the driveway.
This concludes our time for this session of Common Ground Church and Community. We thank you so much for watching. But before you get out of here, click that subscribe button down below, right there, down below. Click that button so you can get all of our updates on our next videos, so that you can be a part of the journey that we take, Common Ground.